Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Common Ground. Thank you so much for braving the rain. That was a wild storm earlier. So you guys are the brave souls. Thank you very much. A special thank you to our live audience. We're actually live streaming this tonight, which is very exciting. It's the first time that we've done it during a Common Ground event. So everyone who's tuned in, thank you very much. We want to give a special thank you to Dean Shields, Heather Ripito, and the Common Ground alumni who are here tonight. This is a very special event. We haven't done anything like this in the past, and we're just really excited that everyone's present and is able to be a part of this, and everyone who's put in so much effort to make this event happen and to be a reality. So thank you so much. Yeah. A few housekeeping things just before we get started. If somehow you manage to bypass the entrance table, please swipe your Vanderbilt card. Hannah is over there. If you could swipe your Vanderbilt card, if you do not have a Vanderbilt card, if you could write your name down. Also, following the presentation, we're gonna have a very exciting networking hour, so if you don't have one of these beauties, get one of those. And additionally, this is our final Common Ground event of the year. So this has been a very exciting year for myself and Colleen. We're the co-presidents. We've loved seeing how Common Ground has grown. We're really excited that the alumni are here tonight to see how it's transitioned since it began for them. So it's just really special for us, and we just wanted to thank everyone very, very much for coming out and supporting us tonight. So thank you. And now Colleen is going to introduce our speaker for the night. Thanks, guys.
It is such a pleasure to be the person to introduce our final speaker of the year. Not only is he extremely impressive professionally, but he is a delightful person, so that's always wonderful. So Dr. Van Schaack is a professor here at Vanderbilt with dual appointments at the Peabody College of Education and the School of Engineering. He's also the Associate Dean for Online Learning. So Dr. Van Schaack teaches courses in social science research methods, organizational psychology, judgment and decision making, and technology forecasting. His research focuses on technologies that make teaching and learning more effective, efficient, and accessible. Dr. Van Schaack has founded and served as chief scientist for several technology companies and has earned 15 patents, granted and pending, for inventions related to adaptive learning systems and digital pens technologies. He holds a bachelor's degree in instructional psychology and a doctorate in instructional technology from Utah State. We are so excited that he could join us tonight and share his knowledge with us, and it's going to be a really fun evening all together. So please help me in welcoming Dr. Andrew Van Schaack.
Well, thank you for that very warm and, in a way, humbling introduction. It's great to be here tonight, and I appreciate the invitation to speak with you and to see some old friends and many new friends. And also, I welcome the people who are tuned in online. It's great to have you here, especially for this evening's discussion about online learning communities, a vision of the future of Vanderbilt. And this is a topic that I've been thinking about for a long time. Back when I was in graduate school studying instructional technology, one of my possible, of many, dissertation topics was on the care and feeding of online communities. So at the time, Utah State University, where I was at, had an agreement with MIT. And MIT at that time was developing their open courseware program, where they put all of their courses online for free around the world. What we realized at Utah State was just putting content online doesn't mean that content is really accessible. People have questions. People want to connect with other people. And so we received a funding from the Hewlett Foundation to develop online learning communities around those courses so that when people accessed the information and had questions, they would post it online and other people would connect with them and they would answer each other's questions. And so we spent a lot of time thinking about strategies we could use to enhance the sense of community in that particular world. And here I am now, probably 15 years later, standing in front of you now, as I was just recently provided with the honor and the title of Associate Dean for Online Programs, to figure out how we do the exact same thing at Vanderbilt University. Because one of the really real values that we have here, and the reason that we're all sitting here together, is because of that sense of connectedness we have with each other and with the faculty. And what we want to make sure that we do is we bring more people to Vanderbilt University, that we bring them into this community that we've developed. So That's our topic of discussion for tonight, and I truly mean a discussion because this great format that we have is I'll be presenting for about 15 minutes and just sharing some information with you. And as you all know, having done this before, we'll have a couple of questions for you to think about. We'll work at the tables and then come back and have a discussion amongst ourselves. So this is Peabody College, so we need to start with a quote from John Dewey. John Dewey says, if we teach today's students as we taught yesterday, we rob them of tomorrow. And this really means a lot to me. As a professor who has an appointment in the School of Engineering, one of the courses I teach is technology forecasting and assessment, how to predict the future. Because if you can predict the future, you can be part of creating it. And so what I'd like to say to you tonight is we know what the future of education is. We know where things are heading. And there's no place like Peabody College that should be responsible and engaged in the process of creating that future that we would like to make for ourselves. And that's really the topic of tonight's discussion and of our activities moving forward. So one of the things that we're going to be talking about is different types of learning environments. I just want to make sure we have some vocabulary straight between ourselves. There are traditional types of courses, and that's many of the courses that are taught at Vanderbilt or have been taught for the last 100 years, where there's really no online teaching. The content is just simply delivered written or orally. This is where a lot of unofficial teaching happens during office hours. But it could be a person with a stick in the sand sharing the Pythagorean theorem. This could be a mentor-apprentice model where you're sharing information with people, but we really don't need technology to help facilitate that. We have web-facilitated instruction, which is really what we have here at Peabody College and what we have around Vanderbilt University, where courses have a web-based component. So we use Blackboard, we use Safe Assignment, students submit things, we send them out onto the net to go gather information. So we use the internet as a means to exchange information and to access and analyze various resources. There are blended and hybrid programs where, and this is happening a lot with our professional programs, we see this in the EDD program at LPO, Leadership Policy and Organization, we see this in Owen Graduate School of Business. We see it where people will do part of their courses online at a distance, but they fly into Vanderbilt University frequently to engage in immersive experiences. And so we do have hybrid programs here at Vanderbilt University. And then there's online programs. And this could be where basically almost all of it is done at a distance. Now, what we're talking about at Peabody College moving forward, and I'll share more information about our programs that we'll be launching in September, but this might be where three times during a program that lasts for 3 years, you come to Vanderbilt University. So it's really the vast majority of it is done at a distance, and occasionally you'll come in for orientation, or you'll come for various immersion experiences. We have this at Vanderbilt University right now. Our nursing school has graduate degrees that are online. So this program has been in the nursing school, various programs have been available for some time. We also have some professional programs through the Owen Graduate School of Business that are not necessarily degree granting but are certificate programs. And so there is some precedent at Vanderbilt University for online learning. So what we really are going to be talking about is that online component down at the bottom, where the majority of the courses are taken from people who don't live in Nashville. They live in Jerome, Idaho, or Cupertino, California, or wherever they live, and they're actually part of the Vanderbilt community with Vanderbilt email addresses, Vanderbilt swag, right? They're coming to campus and they're feeling part of this community. And that's what we really want to talk about tonight is how do we make them part of this community? Now what I've worked on for quite some time, and Ted Hasselbring, who's joined us this evening, has worked on some time, are strategies where we can use technology to make learning more effective and more efficient. And so we really study behavioral psychology, cognitive psychology, and think to what extent can we use technology to support limitations of human information processing. That's not tonight's talk. I love that topic, and I'd love to share with you how we can use technology to help people learn. Tonight's topic is about online communities and creating a sense of community, an equally important aspect of learning. I'd like to make the case for why we should be even having this discussion. So some work has been done at Babson, and they've done it for a little bit more than 10 years, and they've looked at the percentage of students in the United States of America at post-secondary universities that are providing degrees. And when we look at from 2004 to 2014, a period of 10 years, we see that a little bit over 10% of students back in 2004, upwards of 30% of students are taking courses online. Now, we don't see a lot of this at Peabody College. We don't see a lot of this at Vanderbilt University, so it seems like maybe that number seems pretty high, like 30% of students are taking courses online, but this is at post-secondary degree-granting institutions around the United States of America. There are a lot of programs that have big-name universities that have online programs, and that number is growing, and I would expect that number to continue to grow until it basically reaches nearly 100%. Now, this is not people who are taking all of their courses online. These are individuals who have taken, in the fall of 2014, or in the fall of these years, took at least one course online. So these are the stats for fall of 2014. More than one in four higher ed students enrolled in at least one of their courses online. One in four. More than one in seven higher ed students took all of their courses exclusively online in fall of 2014. That's the latest data I have. I think that's remarkable. One in seven students who will receive a degree from a college or university takes all of their courses online. Pretty remarkable. And I think those numbers are going to go higher and higher. This is also something that's viewed by the chief learning officers who were surveyed, as well as other executives at universities. How important is online education to your institution? So these are the results. Do you agree with the statement that online programs are critical, mission critical to your university? And more than 70% of people now agree with that statement, that online learning is critical to what we do. There are some people who disagree, and that number is slowly creeping down and down as more people shift into the idea that this is something we need to do. So this is an important initiative for Vanderbilt University to be partnering with 2U in developing some programs. And maybe some of you already know this, but this is a press release. Thank you, Joe, for helping to produce this fine work and getting the message out to the world that online graduate degree programs for educators are launched by Vanderbilt University. So in February of this year, we signed a contract, and we're working with a fantastic group called 2U. They have offices around the country, but primarily in New York. And they're working with us to help bring our programs to a broader audience. 2U has worked with other institutions like Vanderbilt, Yale, Georgetown, USC, NYU, Simmons, and basically we're the 17th university they've worked with. So these are institutions that I think we can be proud to say that we're associated with and bring in our programs. Simmons, while I was talking with them, they have six different programs and thousands of students who are in their online programs, including their nursing program, which they've received accolades for the fine work that they're doing. So this is something we're doing at Vanderbilt University. I'd be happy to answer some questions that you have either during our Q&A period or when we have a beer in our hands. Maybe better with a beer in our hands. So what we're here to talk about right now is this idea of sense of community. And just like many other concepts that we can come up with, there's been fantastic research done on this in the Journal of Community Psychology. This definition of a sense of community is a feeling that members have of belonging, a feeling that members matter to one another and to the group, and a shared faith that members' needs will be met through the commitment to be together. I think that's a terrific definition of community, and I think that's the feeling that we have and communities that we are in our lives, especially in our graduate programs here at Vanderbilt. Researchers, of course, want to investigate this idea of community, and in fact, there is a sense of community index, and who knew? Our own Doug Perkins has done research in the validation of a particular index, so something that can be measured to determine this idea of sense of community. I was stopping by his office to say, I'm going to be chatting with you a little bit about your work. I noticed his paper is right outside his door. But the idea that membership, which really has the attributes of boundaries, emotional safety, a sense of belonging, identification, personal investment, a common symbol system, the idea that you can influence and be influenced by others, the idea that you have integration and fulfillment of needs, that you feel rewarded in some way for your participation in the community, and this idea of shared emotional connection. That, by the way, is the definitive element for a true community, this idea of shared emotional connection. So what we need to do is understand this particular concept and not just observe it, but I'm a big believer in doing research on it. So one of the questions I always ask my students is, what's the difference between change and progress? Progress requires measurement and comparison. I think there's a lot of work that can be done using qualitative methods, but I think there's work that we can do in the quantitative methods. I think there's ways that we can actually evaluate on an ongoing basis how effectively we are in creating the sense of community. So, of course, there's this concept called community of inquiry, and this is really communities around learning, where we talk about interaction with peers, interaction with content, interaction with the instruction, and of course, in the intersection of content and peers and instruction, that's where learning happens. We support discourse, we set a climate, and we select content. Those are the things that happen between learners and peers and the instructor. And really what we're trying to maximize is this concept of social presence, of cognitive presence and teaching presence. And just to tell you briefly what those are, teaching presence is the relationship that I have with my learners, my ability to project myself onto this online course, that you get a sense of me, even though we're separated by a distance. The ability of a community of learners to construct meaning through sustained communication, this is the cognitive presence. It develops the students collaborate to explore, construct, resolve, and confirm their understanding of content. So this is learners working with the content, trying to make sense of it. And then, of course, the one that we're here to talk about tonight is social presence, the learner connecting with learners, that you develop a sense of community. You can project yourself socially and emotionally to really develop real relationships. Now, when people investigate what factors influence sense of community, these are the variables that have been explored. And you can read through this list faster than I can read it to you. But what's interesting is they look at how important those are and how frequently they occur. And on this handy-dandy little graph here, it turns out the one that's most important and happens most frequently in creating a sense of community is entire class discussions, when groups work together. Other ones that are important are small group discussions, exchanging resources, and contributing personal experiences or things that have happened. The one in the bottom left-hand corner are icebreakers. Doesn't do a lot to develop a sense of community, so we can avoid those after the first day of class. So what I want to share with you, if I may, is a video that shows a little bit about what these courses are going to look like with our partners at 2U. And one of the things I want you to look at is sort of the range of examples of forms of instruction and actually sort of the production quality. What's this going to look like? Now I can show a little bit more examples, but I think you get an idea that sometimes the instruction is, of course, the talking head, and I'm talking to you. Sometimes I'm using my laptop computer and sharing what the presentation looks like. Sometimes I'm interviewing people. The people that might be interviewed could be an expert. It could be a simulation of a counseling session students, grad students who I'm asking and answering questions with. The other video I wanted to show you before I close out, that was right there is what we call the asynchronous instruction. So if you take a course at Vanderbilt University through its online program, one part of it will be the asynchronous instruction, where you go online, you download resources, you watch videos, you go off and collect information and sort of do some homework. The other part is the synchronous component, and that's where you're using video conferencing technologies to check in with your group. And I'd like to show you a video of what that looks like.
Collaboration in terms of not only being able to speak directly to the professor, but we have we're in live sessions, we have class together, we have group assignments together, and we all have our webcams on. It's almost like I'm sitting in their living room. I am a firm believer that we are on the cusp of something special. The program itself is innovative, and it allows someone like myself, who has a child and is a working professional, to obtain a graduate level degree. This is an elite program, top 20. It's amazing. I would not be able to do this anywhere else.
So that's an example of asynchronous instruction and synchronous instruction, and that's essentially the type of quality and the type of experiences you'll see in the graduate programs that we're developing here at Peabody. So that's my 15 minutes of fame. And what I wanted to do now is transition into topics for discussion. And I know that I'm going to have some help from some of the visiting folks, so I don't know if Jeff, you'll be coming up here, or someone else will be talking about this, or whomever else. But we've got a couple questions that we'd like you to think about for the next several minutes. The first one is, what factors influence sense of community in your graduate degree program? So I'd like you to think about for a period of time, what makes you feel connected to each other and makes you feel connected to Vanderbilt University? And then the question is, of course, we're interested in is what strategies could be used to enhance that sense of community in online programs, and not just while you're here at Vanderbilt University, but after you leave Vanderbilt University, but you'd like to stay connected as an alumni, potential mentor, and someone else who has a vested interest in this community of practice.
So something that we do every time at a Common Ground event and that we'll be doing during our discussion and activity that the alumni will present in just a second is that we are going to do a text-in. So you guys can all see on your tables their orange sheets, and this is a way that we can not only have a conversation at our tables but have a conversation out loud as well. So what you can do is text Common Ground 334 to the number 22333. And as you text any questions, comments, if you hear something really inspiring, if you start thinking, I'm a little confused about this, then you can text that in and it will pop up and then everyone can see that and we'll share it at the end. But while that's going on, our next portion is that I'm gonna allow the Common Ground alumni to come up here, introduce themselves, and talk about our next portion of the night. So thank you guys.
How's it going? I'm Jeff George. I came back from San Francisco to be here with you all this evening. So just a little bit of background about myself and sort of the organization as a whole. I started this program with Laura Bantle back when we were grad students in our 2013-14 year, and the whole idea is to actually kind of build this greater sense of Peabody community. You know, she was in the special education program, I was in the IEPM program. We were both on the Fuchs project, but we never spoke until the end of the year. We went out for coffee. It lasted like 3 hours or something, as all of our dialogue tends to do. Anyway, but we realized that we all care about the same things. We all want to solve the same problems. And, you know, if you read Peabody's mission statement, it's all about dissemination of knowledge across, like, just broadly. As broad as possible, all about, and we're connecting people who care about the human condition. So that's the idea, right? So we want this to extend. So we've been brought in with the, because to you and this, like, this opportunity, actually, this program offers an opportunity for us to really think beyond what we think about with online courses and things like this. I worked at edX, and now I currently work at Adobe, so this online learning space is where I've been focusing for the past few years, and we can do much more. There's, like, we can go so much further than where other, like, the other programs, I believe we can go much further than that to actually develop a true sense of online, like, one Peabody community, online, on campus, alumni together. So that's what I'm really excited to explore with you all tonight.
Like Jeff said, my name is Laura. I am still here in the Nashville area, but I've moved back into the classroom. I work at a local high school, and different from Jeff, I'm not associated with the online world at all, but I have stayed connected with Common Ground first of all, just by being excited that it continued to exist. Because when we say that we kicked it off, like, we said, we have this idea, and then he ran to Dean Shields. And then we were like, let's try some stuff. And it didn't really exist until Sunan and Peyton came along the next year and gave it form that you know of it today. But I'm back in the classroom, and a lot of you here are students. I just feel like it's important to state that it can be shocking to realize how quickly, once you go back into the professional world, how quickly you lose your connection to your academic resources. You lose connection to your learning community. You think of yourself as a learner, but then you get into the routine of your life and your work, and you don't have access to the same educational resources. And it's just such a shame, in the way that it was a shame when we were together on campus and never spoke across the silos of the programs. It's a huge shame to not be able to harness the power of the Peabody community throughout the entirety of your career. And so when we heard about what's happening with the new online platforms, we were really excited to think about how can we continue to connect our alumni networks and spread what we learn here and continue to be learners. And now, what if on my campus with my colleagues, I can live stream one of the events here on campus and we can discuss it together the way you all are discussing it at the tables? So we're really excited to hear what you all think could be possible as we transition. I'm gonna turn it over to Sanana.
All right. Hi, everybody. How's it going? Good? Good. Oh, I'm so glad to hear that. Raise your hand if you are a second year and you're graduating very soon. Raise them high. Excellent. Congratulations to you all. Raise your hand if you're a first year then. Lots of first years here too. Raise your hand if you were thinking about a job after you graduate from this program. I would imagine every hand would be raised in the room, but maybe you guys are just, you're set. One reason that we're excited is because I think Laura's absolutely, I should say first, my name's Nana Chand, I live in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I actually lead a network of about 250 organizations in Pittsburgh that are all thinking about the future of learning and how to work together to achieve a more active, engaging, technology-enhanced learning environment for all kids. I thrive off networks, it's what I do. And I also felt the sense that when I left the Vanderbilt community, that network, that community that was built here, kind of went away, unless you really had to maintain it by yourself. And so what Dean Shields brought to us as an idea, which I think could really enhance the online community that was just spoken of, is not only a paid subscription where you pay for classes and master programs, that could be tier one. But imagine that there's also a tier two on this platform that's actually free for alumni to just join. And there are things on there like job postings and resources and events across the country where you can come together under different topics that you might be interested in. This idea that we can build an alumni community, whether or not you're taking a course or not, and actually be able to communicate across years, across programs, and get a lot of information and resource out of Vanderbilt even after you graduate. And you may not be thinking about that right now, but I guarantee you when you start to look for a job and you're away from Vanderbilt and away from campus, it could be very helpful to have a job board of all your alumni, friends from years past who have connections and resources for you out in the world. So we want to think about that today, and we want to help you all, we want to get you guys to kind of help co-design that with us. And so through these questions, we're really going to get from you some ideas of how to build that second tier too. What kind of things would you want to get out of an alumni network or a platform alumni so you would actually use it? And what kind of things could you give and contribute once you're an alumni as well? So we're happy to be here and talk with you all. We're going to float around as you're asking, Laura and I will at least, as you're answering those questions and gather information. So thank you so much.
I'll jump in. So just in case there are people who haven't been here for previous events, at your tables, you're going to have an opportunity to discuss. I would really, really recommend that you use the orange paper to make sure that you can text in. We want to keep a log of everything that's happening with the discussion. And because we're talking about a shift to online learning platforms, we want to try to use this platform tonight and make sure that we're experimenting with the technology that's been in place this year, but we're adding in live streaming and we're really trying to capture things. But if you still think the way that I think, there are also some Post-its available, writing utensils. Like I said, we'll be popping around, but don't feel, you know, let the conversation take you through brainstorming. That's really what we're excited about tonight. And then either Colleen or Christina will bring us back when it's time. Thank you.
So both of them?
Yeah, I might as well just
duets? Islands in the Stream?
Yeah, so just turn it on and it'll... You're not going to hear it.
Okay, oh, they're on.
All right, so I'll introduce myself. This is Andy. I was just speaking, so I'm part of this fantastic group.
Hi, I'm Amanda. I'm a second year master's student in the International Education and Policy Program.
I'm Will French. I'm a second year student in the Human Development Counseling Program, specifically the school track. So I'm one of the students of the program that's going to go online in the fall. So
I'm Elizabeth Evans. I'm a first year in the Elementary Education Program.
And I'm Jeff, and I was speaking recently as well. Welcome to the conversation. We can start with a couple of the questions that were up there. I don't think the mics were on before when you answered the questions about cost and everything, so just a couple of logistical questions and everything. Just
not transition to the ones that we're supposed to do for our homework.
Yeah,
so as I sat down, I just want to say, so some of the mics up there, so how much does the Vanderbilt EdD degree program cost? We also have a master's degree in school counseling that we're going to be offering. So online degrees cost the exact same amount as on-campus degrees. I mean, we're having some discussions about, do I need to pay facilities fees if I live in Jerome, Idaho, and I'm not using the gym? But some of those fees might be used for some other kinds of things as well that they might have access to. But basically, the degrees cost the same. In terms of what it looks like on your transcript or what it looks like on the diploma, it's exactly the same. If you put the diploma in your office and you put the diploma in your office, I don't see any different words. If I look at your transcript, I see the same courses listed. So it's not like there's an O in front of it or something else that would distinguish it as being different to a prospective employer or somebody else. I mean, it really is the very same degree. And that's really the challenge for us, is how do we make sure that these degrees have the exact same quality, you get the same opportunities to learn in the online programs you do on campus.
Yeah, and that's a great transition into, like, so if their degrees are going to be the same, everything like this, and it's not just about the program quality, it's also about the experiences that they have as students.
Right.
So if you have a couple questions about sense of community for these students, that would be great. So,
sure. I think for me, I was sort of thinking about, I mean, you gave some really helpful language around how to think about and then even sort of measure community. And so I was, you know, that obviously made me think about my own experience and my own sense of community in my current program. And so I guess I'm wondering, my own personal experience in my program is that, you know, it wasn't as easy necessarily for me to feel a strong sense of community in my current grad school program, and I actually found a lot of sense of community by being involved here in Common Ground, by being involved, as you sort of described, you know, with the people on my Fuchs team and other sort of organizations on campus. So I'm really curious about ways that we can, for students who are online, who I know that there are a lot of people online who do find that sense of community. I think about Tumblr. Tumblr is one of those spaces where people become fast friends and long-term friends. So that will work, I know, for lots of people. So then for the people who don't necessarily feel that, how can we build in those other opportunities so that they can find that community?
What's interesting is it seems like your sense of community came from outside the classroom.
Yes.
You didn't say, my sense of community came from the in-class discussions that we had that were really engaging, we're working on stuff, or the team projects that we're working on. I'm not saying that didn't, wasn't there, but it was sort of outside in clubs and organizations and other kind of activities where potentially you could take a leadership role and do things like that. So I'm curious for each of you, and I'm thinking about my grad school experience as well. To what extent did this sense of community come from what happened in the classroom versus what happened after hours? What would you think?
I would say both. I would say my sense of community has come from my cohort. Right. And part of it is that I have a large cohort. There's 25 of us. I don't know how that compares to counseling.
I have 41. So.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So maybe that's part of it. But my first year, we took 5 of our 6 courses together, so we had a lot of FaceTime in the classroom, and that's something I really valued and a point I wanted to bring up in the discussion here. But I think the personal bonding that happened with those people, but outside of the classroom. So I didn't get as involved as Will did in the on-campus organizations, but it was those people. Yeah.
Cards Against Humanity,
beer, yeah, just going to happy hour, going to see concerts together, all those things.
It's a bonding experience.
It is.
Yeah. What about you? So I, in my elementary education cohort, there's only 11 of us. So initially, at the beginning of this year, when we were all new to each other, a lot of the bonding and sense of community came through in the classes. So we were all taking 7 classes. They were all together.
Right.
We don't have any other students in our classes at all.
Right.
So a lot of this, the friendships that started and the community and the bonding revolved around what was happening in our classes.
Right.
I think as first semester and as the second semester has progressed, a lot of that community has kind of grown outside of the classroom. So it will be a Thursday night, we'll have our literacy class, it's our last class of the week, and we'll be like, okay, like, no one's doing work tonight, like, what are we gonna go do? And it's one of those things where we didn't quite have that at the beginning of the program because we didn't know each other, and after we bonded over kind of an academic paper that was super hard or a test that kind of like blew our mind because we all failed it or whatever it was, we created this community that then extended beyond the classroom. So it was a little bit of both.
You sort of co-located, but you had to struggle to do something.
Yeah.
You had to work on something.
It's this common struggle, or like, ooh, that class was like brutal, or like, sweet, we got out of class 30 minutes early, like, this professor rocks. That's how it started, but it's definitely grown past that, and especially with having such a small cohort, and we all get along, luckily, that.
For me, obviously, when I was here, it started with the cohort. That's where you spend most of your time. You're taking all the same classes, you're talking about the same assignments and everything like that. But the broader goals that I came into this university with were to try to make an impact in education. To do that, you need to connect with teachers, especially, who are in the classrooms, like all this sort of thing. You need the policymakers who are making the policies. Like, you need all stakeholders involved. You need to bring them together. So one of the things, like, and especially, and it really got me thinking about this online space because MOOCs were just taking off at that point, right? We're talking about this democratization of education, bringing all these different voices that we've never heard from before, which is a really exciting concept. And then, but kind of what you're talking about is how do we, like, coming back to the building of sense of community, how do we give them all these other opportunities to connect with each other beyond just the course content? Because those conversations are happening in forums, and they're happening based on videos already, that kind of stuff, AMAs, Tumblr, that sort of thing. But a lot of the times, like the institutions that were doing really amazing things, we're bringing students to campus. We're having like design boot camp sort of things in different locations. They had hubs that were kind of self-created, where people were meeting face-to-face on a weekly basis. And then the best professors were the ones who were able to encourage that in a way that was structured, but also fluid enough where they can make it their own. So it's really complicated, but that's where I think we're really excited. I was so excited when Dean Shields was talking about live streaming all this. Because right now, they're going to live stream it. We're going to host it. We're going to save it. We're going to have that YouTube channel. People are going to refer back to it. We have these questions coming up, like all these sorts of things. We're able to now create this huge network. Imagine if all these alumni watched this and said, hey, I'm in San Fran. I watched that. Who wants to talk about it? It's good for coffee.
Yeah.
So what functionality would need to be in place to do that? So we've thought about classes. I saw the classes, and you have the videos, and you have all the discussions, which seem great for in class. But outside of class, what are the features, and what are the other things that need to kind of be thought about and integrated into it? Because you can integrate things through APIs and things these days. But what do we want to integrate? Is it just a chat forum? Is it a geolocator to allow you to find students that are close to you? Look up by region? All those sorts of things. So I don't know. I put that kind of, what would you like to see in an online course?
Okay. yes, I'm so excited that this is going to be made available on YouTube, and I think I'm someone who thinks a lot, probably too much, but I would love to, after I graduate, be able to go onto YouTube and find more Common Ground sessions that are happening and just watch those videos online or Crucial Conversations. They have their sort of annual, semi-annual discussions on race and diversity that's sort of specific to Peabody, but also is broader than that. And so I think, if we can expand activities or speaking events that are happening here on campus more broadly to alums, to even current students who for one reason or another can't even make it here tonight because classes have been pushed to later, content can still be accessible to them, and they can, two friends who couldn't be here tonight can still watch it on their own and then meet up later and talk about it and be like, hey, did you see that really interesting event that just happened? That's really awesome. Or you didn't see it, go watch it yourself tonight. I feel like I hear so often that from people in my own cohort that, they're like, oh, I wish I could have gone, but I was just so tired or whatever. Well, they can go home, curl up on the couch, and, still watch what's happening at home and then talk about it the next day with someone else. So I just feel like, absolutely, there are ways to make all this kind of material accessible. So,
I think the idea of asynchronous instruction and time shifting, and this is, I think, what's going to be great about an online program is that there are some people, as you saw in the video, I've got a spouse, I've got some kids, I can't quit my job, I can't move across the country, but I want to get that Vanderbilt education. And how can I work with the schedule that I have? So you guys know how difficult it is to find the classes that work for you and to try to have a job and make that work together. But imagine if one half of what you do can happen anytime. You're at a Starbucks, you're listening to a video or something like that as you're on the train or on the bus, watching that sort of thing. So I think one of the benefits of online education is there's a large component of it that's asynchronous, which provides more flexibility, but still provides that synchronous component of being able to see people. One of the things that I just touched on briefly, but we should kind of mention, is we want to make sure that we kick off all of our programs with an immersion that happens very early. So if we're going to be in this program together for 2 years or 3 years, I just want to meet you in person, I see your face, and I know how tall you are, I know how fun you are, and all the rest. And then we're only just heads. I just know more about your character, right, as opposed to what the folks at 2U have told us. And all the different implementations around the country, sometimes people say, let's put the immersion at the end of the first year, and then people show up and it's like, who knew you were 6'7", or who knew you were, kind of funny, or, have this sort of personality. So I think we want to bring in the immersions. I think we want to bring that face-to-face component of actually seeing people physically as part of these programs. And they're built into it, but not in a way that would financially preclude a lot of people being part of the program. The other thing I want to mention, too, is that these are not, I mean, MOOCs are great. EdX kicks butt. I mean, MIT, Harvard, and all the rest. But some of these are enormous. So the sections that we're going to have for these courses are going to be like what you saw up there. It's going to be, you know, the Brady Bunch blocks, and there'll be a maximum of 16 people at a time, because that's neatly 4x4. But the class sections, the class size is going to be somewhere between 10 and 15 with an instructor. So it's not like as soon as you go online, then suddenly, boom, the thing blows up and there's 1,000 people whom you never know. It really is going to be a small group of people that you'll be working with during the course of that term.
Can I respond?
Yeah. Please.
Okay. So I must say, before tonight, I was very pessimistic about the online platform. Just my experience as a high school teacher, I value that face-to-face interaction. Yeah. But I was encouraged when I saw the clip about the synchronous learning, in particular because I reflect on what I've learned so far in my cohort. And for me, about half of my cohort is international, and they have really diverse experiences and life practical skills that they've brought to the classroom conversation, to the point where I feel like I've learned more from my peers than from my instructor. And so to me, that's been a hallmark of my learning at Vanderbilt. And so the idea of potentially losing that on just potentially a chat forum or some type of, you know, asynchronous instruction was quite worrisome to me. But then when I saw the part about synchronous instruction, I was like, oh, there's still that option for that type of in-time feedback that has led to the discussions that I found most fruitful during my time.
One of the things that wasn't shown in the video, we have limited time, thank you, is you can have breakout sessions. So as the instructor, I can say, I want to put you three off in this room, so we're using Adobe Connect. You four are in this group, and you two are in this group, and I want you to go off and talk for a little bit. And then suddenly you and I are just doing a one-to-one, you know, Skype chat, and you know, or you know, Adobe Connect chat. You guys are doing your three people, do your work, and then come back and report. So it's your job. So I think there's going to be a lot of opportunities for individuals to really interact with each other. Now, I don't get the entire body language. You know, I can't pat you on the shoulder and say how awesome you are. I think we're going to miss some of those dynamics, but I don't think those are going to be the significant parts of how we interact with each other. It's looking each other in the eye. It's laughing. It's shared experience, shared challenges. And so I appreciate your hesitation. Like, if this is kind of what I thought it was going to be, like correspondence course, except high tech, it's like that's like sense of community, good luck there.
I was happy to see that as well in your presentation, but I do really want to hit home that just from a very personal point of view, I connect with people a lot better when it's face-to-face.
Sure.
And so I think just hitting home the point that having those times for immersion at the beginning of a program, during the program, at the end, whenever that is, and whatever kind of the research shows is right for that, I think that is really important to integrate into Vanderbilt's online programs or any others, because some people just do not flourish online. I am example like A, like right here, not my thing. But so I think just having that time to have that face-to-face interaction and get to know people on that more personal level before you dive into those video chats and going into the, you know, us three going into a small group for 20 minutes or whatever that is online, I think that could be extremely beneficial.
May I respond briefly?
Oh, sure.
I just want to say, this is one of the things that I didn't know about either. And so when I was at a symposium with 2U and a lot of the peer institutions, and I mentioned Yale and Simmons and Georgetown, and there's just a lot of other great ones, that was the question I really had as well. And what they said was, certainly there are people who are like, I could not work in an online environment. And I asked my undergrad students this as well. I said, how many of you would like to do a degree online? And almost no hands go up. It's like, but you can kind of study whenever you want. You get this flexibility. And a lot of people were saying, but I would never get out of bed. Like, I just need to go. And I'm not suggesting this is you, but some people say, I just need the impetus to wake up, to go in, to take the quiz, to listen to the lecture, and that sort of thing. Other people just say, I just want to pat them on the shoulder. I just want to look you in the eye. I just want to get a sense of what you're saying. And that's great. Then do the on-campus program for sure. But there are other people who say, you know, I think ideally, I wish I could be in Nashville. Ideally, I wish I could take, like you guys have, 2 years off.
So I'm going to just quickly try to connect some of the questions. Yeah. Just like maybe 2 more minutes. 2 minutes?
Nope.
2 minutes. 2 minutes. These are big questions, so I guess it's kind of really important. All right. So I'm actually deeply passionate about some of the questions up, and if you want to take a look, you can see. But like, how do race and ethnicity play a role? Impacts of environment and physical space, but also the larger thing that we were talking about of connecting the on-campus, off-campus, and alumni, right? Right. So if we build this larger, if we think about the community as much larger, one Peabody, right? Where this is something that everybody, whether you're in the courses or outside the courses, can be a part of in some way. And this is a place where everyone can connect and they can find people with the expertise, that kind of stuff. How might that look? Like, would you like that? Would you take advantage of that? That sort of thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, because it seems like if we could envision something beyond outside the course, we need to include stuff that's outside the course as well as in the course. And especially connecting the on-campus and off-campus students. Because you're going to bring in a lot of those diverse perspectives, but the core perspectives from the core students
is
incredibly important as well for them to get exposure to that.
So
I think it opens a lot of doors, but we have to think about it from like a design perspective. We have to think about how we want to add our voices to that. That's what I want. Sorry.
All right, so it sounds like some of those discussions are wrapping up, and it is time for us to move into the final part of our program. We're going to do a question and answer session with Dr. Van Schaack. We have seen so many really, really thought-provoking questions up on our text-in screen. Feel free to ask one that isn't yours. Feel free to take inspiration from it. And please, by all means, feel free to fire away. Dr. Van Schaack?
Oh, did you say fire away, Dr. Van Schaack?
Maybe.
So take advantage of firing away at Dr. Van Schaack. All right. Well, that was fun. A bunch of questions were scrolling up the screen. I remember a few of them. And let me just say, first and foremost, I am the type of professor who's very comfortable saying, I don't know. So there may be several questions where I just simply don't know the answer to the question, either because I don't know and the answer is known, or the answer isn't known, because that's what we're sort of exploring together. There's a lot of things that we do know about online learning. There's a lot that we know about working with 2U and creating these courses online in a way that we think is going to be effective. But this truly is a new initiative for us here at the university, and so there's a lot of things that we need to figure out and figure out together as we move forward. One of the questions I saw up there, so before I won't even turn around, was how much does the degrees cost? The degrees online cost the same amount as the degrees on campus. There may be a small difference, and we're talking about that with respect to things like facility fees. Do I need inoculations? And some of the things that might be like, why would I need this if I live in Cupertino, California, if I'm not taking advantage of that? So one of the things we're looking at is some of those smaller things, but the degree costs the same. Is the degree any different on the transcript or on the diploma? No, it's not. It's not like it's going to say, I have an EdD from Vanderbilt University or a master's degree in school counseling online, you know, in italics or in parentheses somewhere. So the transcript will look the same and the diploma looks the same. These are the same degrees in terms of the rigor, the quality, and that's what we want to make sure that we ensure and that we project to people. What's another good question that I can't read because it's behind me and the question scrolled off? Maybe if you have a hand, raise a hand and ask me a question. Or should I just, yes. I thought that was a great question, and that one I'm not certain of the answer on. That's one of the questions I'm sure that the answer is known. So if I apply to Vanderbilt University, I want to get this EdD, can I have a 7-year-old computer with a dial-up connection? Or do I have to have some, right? That's going back to my generation, AOL. I'm sure there's going to be some minimum technological requirement that's going to be what we have to make sure that our students meet. But I don't know what that level is. But I would be convinced of that. Because we're using Adobe Connect, fantastic technology, but as you can see, the fidelity of that connection would be very, very important to create that sense of connectedness. Yes?
As you were starting to address this question towards the end of our small group conversation, but I think for me, one of the questions I have is, you know, who are these online degree programs trying to attract? And so, you know, right. Whether I wonder access to financial aid because they don't have on-campus access to work-study programs or, you know, and so just by that nature, then the cost is higher. And so, and you know, we all know how race and ethnicity and socioeconomic status, you know, sort of go hand in hand there. So, so I guess I'm just sort of wondering, you know, what kind of efforts are going to be made around trying to ensure that there are diverse student bodies who are being recruited, and socioeconomically diverse student bodies, et cetera, all of those things.
Right. And so that is a question that comes up every single time that we collectively get together as an executive team and other people who are trying to shape this program. So I can assure you that's a question that we continue to address. And one of the things that we do is talk to our peer institutions and ask them what strategies that they're using. So one of the things that we worked on that was very difficult to do was ensure that the calendar for our online program conformed to the calendar of our on-campus program. That seems pretty trivial to you all, but it turns out that a lot of financial aid is tied in with making sure that we have start dates and end dates that align with how federal agencies provide funding to to students. So we're sort of making sure that we're not precluding, we're not limiting the ability to get financial aid that's tied in with the calendar. The other thing that we think, that I've heard as an argument made is that the ability to get a degree from Vanderbilt University is predicated on a lot of things. One is my ability to pay for my degree, but the other one is to pull up my roots, unless you're a Nashville native, and move here, and for many people, not work full-time with perhaps a family. And the idea of being able to keep your full-time job, live in Wyoming, and still work to get a degree might make it more financially accessible for many people. I was talking with the folks at 2U who are responsible for doing a lot of the marketing work to bring students in, and I asked them specifically that question. What strategies are you using to reach a more diverse population? How will we measure that, track that? Remember what I said earlier about what's the difference between change and progress? Progress requires measurement and comparison. What standards will we set ourselves to ensure that we have diversity that meets or exceeds that which we see with our on-campus program? So this is one where I don't have simple answers. Let me tell you the seven things that we're going to do, clickety, 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 clickety. In fact, I have a slide for it. I didn't have time to bring it up. I don't have the specific answers for that, but it's something that we're absolutely working on. And if you have input, I mean, this is something where you can help shape this program. Things that worked to draw you in or others that you knew that were able to come to this program, and you can think this would be great for online programs, please share those with us. So. Yes?
If a program has an online and on-campus component, would you ensure that the people work together and that if there are students who are here and students who are online, say that it was that style, would you make sure that students all knew each other or work together with the panel?
Interesting. So let's say that we have two programs, one in Masters of School Counseling on campus and Masters of School and Counseling online. And you'd like to have some way that those students could interact with each other in some way. And do you think that would happen during, and this is, so now we're having a conversation, you and I. And where's that beer in my hand when I need it? Would that happen, do you think, during a course itself or through something like a Common Ground event where you have individuals who are on campus who are participating here, some who are participating online, and they have shared experiences through outside of classroom activities? How do you envision that happening, perhaps?
I think, outside of class would be interesting because, especially if you have, the teleconference, not everyone's going to bring up the same points, not every class would be the same.
Right.
So to be able to, connect and be oh, well, I learned this in class, maybe it went a different direction than another class.
Right. Well, I think the idea too, and I was talking about this with Dr. Shields, is the idea that we're going to have these immersions where people come in on campus and imagine having events where it's not just for the online students and they're sort of over there. It's like a high school dance. The boys are over here. The girls are over there. You know, we could actually have something where it's like, hey, we invite you to meet some of these students who are part of the same program that you're essentially in and they're on campus this weekend. And it might be sort of a mixer and you match people together and you go see a football game or basketball game or go to Hattie B's and stand in line for an hour, right? I just did that with my son, Johnny. And share sort of the Nashville experience with them. I think something like that might happen too. So social events, I think speaker events, clubs and organizations. The reason why I was asking is because outside the classroom, I think that might be challenging, right? Inside the classroom. So good question. Yeah.
been working with 2 years of government program. So how much room is there for platform development, product development, like setting product requirements for the online program to be like, this is what you've done on other campuses, we want more.
Right. So Jeff works at Adobe. I worked at Apple for a number of years. Between two tech guys, I think we can share with them lots of ideas and things that we find that are interesting, but it's going to get into their roadmap, and we'll see that in a couple years. I think if, and that's one of the things I'm very excited about. So let me bring the conversation back to me. But I mean, but my field is instructional technology. I mean, I really love the idea of creating technologies that help us solve these kinds of problems. So one of the things that's going to be kind of fun for me, working with faculty members who are teaching courses, is say, wouldn't it be cool if? Wouldn't it be cool if? And there's enough of those would it be cool ifs, I'd love to take that to them and then do a little bit of a lit review, because I'm a little bit of a nerd in my research methods class, and say, right, rolling of the eyes. Here are instructional strategies that have been shown to be effective that our faculty would love to use. Can you bring into this into your platform? And what can we do to sort of prototype that initially? So I think there is opportunities there to do that on technology. But I also, as you and I both know, working at Adobe, some customer kind of calls you up with an idea and you're like, thanks for the input. We thought of that a year and a half ago. It's on the roadmap, and we'll be bringing it out at some point. Yeah. But I like that idea, and I'm encouraged by the conversations that I've had with them so far about continuing to shape the platform and the technology. Back to you. Yes. In what respect? Do you think like a new type of degree that would be interdisciplinary in nature, or?
Well, I mean, when you're on campus, you have experiences like this one, right? Where
right.
People from HOD and LPO, and all the departments are able to look at what's happening from various perspectives, and that was kind of why Common Ground was started.
Right.
So I'm wondering, you know, yes, the degrees are the same, yes, the cost is the same, but you're losing opportunities like this to really be able to engage in a cross-disciplinary way. You're from professors, for instance, that are, you know, from a
Yeah, you know, I don't know, but let's pretend I was at your table and I wanted to throw out two or three ideas. I think wouldn't it be interesting too if, for instance, let's say there was a favorite lecture in some course, and that could be voted on by students, and maybe that favorite lecture was put into some bin that said, you know, the great speeches or the great lectures, and you could audit that course and maybe listen in on that particular discussion. This is one of the things that we did when I was working with MIT's Open Courseware project, was allowing individuals to rate things. I mean, rate things for this should not be here, NSFW, right? Not safe for the classroom, not safe for here. But the other one was, this is really awesome, or this answer is great. Let's have it filter to the top. So I'm just thinking, again, if we're brainstorming in this very awkward way with me at the microphone and you back in the back of the room, but wouldn't it be kind of cool is maybe if in Van Schaack's research methods class, there's one lecture that students sort of rate highly. And then that one, because of its high rating, gets put into the bin of greatest hits of. Would that be interesting for you to basically watch one or two lectures from some other course because it was highly rated? Raise your hand if you like that idea. Well, there's one idea. So I think maybe we can come up with some other ones that are like that. But I like that idea, and I think ultimately the idea of a common ground where students are invited and are shown what that is, they get to meet the people, then sort of engage with it in this online this way, I think that would be great too. What are the impacts of environmental and physical space on effectiveness of online learning? That's about, I don't know. I think it's questions like this. To me, you know what I think about is, I think that's an interesting research question. I think it's one that I'm sure there's been some literature done on, research done on it, and we can do a literature review on it, pull that in, and see if we can apply the best that research has to offer these kinds of things. But one of the things I do want to know, and maybe I can wrap up by sharing this experience with you, and this is what's tough. I like showing those videos to you because I think it's one thing to wave my hands around and say, these courses are really made well, and there's really some great production quality. But when you see a bunch of the different professors who have their personalities and you see the videos done, I think that kind of shares that. One thing that I saw when I went to this 2U symposium of peer institutions who were sharing their experiences is they had a panel of students that they selected to come in and talk about their experiences. And they were from all across the United States. And every single person had a story about how they really wanted a graduate degree, but how they just couldn't make that work by quitting their jobs and moving their families and uprooting it, doing the things, making the sacrifices that all of you have made to be here. It just wasn't possible for them, and to have that opportunity available for them. But one of the common themes throughout each individual's representation of their experience was this feeling of connectedness, which I found interesting because I was skeptical of it. But they said, you know, you go into these courses and there's 10 to 15 people per section. So it's not like MOOCs, which are great, but it might be 100,000 people. You have no idea who they are. This is a group of people just like that video you saw, 10 to 15 people, and you get to know them by sharing experiences with them, sharing challenges with them, helping them solve their problems. And then, of course, just like that video online, maybe you're interacting with somebody and a little baby comes running in. Remember that video? And then the mom tries to come in and grab the kid, but then here comes the little kid. I mean, those kinds of things are kind of funny, shared experiences, and apparently those things happen a lot in these online courses. And so I think that I'm encouraged by the fact that many other institutions are working on developing these online courses. They continue to grow their programs. They continue to grow students without reducing their standards, both in terms of the quality of the students or the quality of the instructors. And I'm excited about the opportunity of figuring this out together and making this work. And if I had, so my final question is, you're laughing, so this must be a good one. If you had to place a bet for $10 million on whether online degrees will replace higher ed institutions, would you? Place the bet, or would I take the $10 million? I am absolutely certain that we will continue to see online programs grow, but I'm absolutely certain there will always be a place for places like Vanderbilt University and Yale and Georgetown and Stanford and the University of Timbuktu, because there are people who say, I want to go to a place and I want to be with people and I want to have that experience. No doubt about it, but I'm excited about the opportunity of expanding the Vanderbilt experience for people all around the country and ultimately all around the world. Thank you.
So, I want to thank all of you for coming tonight. I want to thank our technology department, our communications. They have left now. Joe DiOrio and Jessica were here. We had people that were joining us tonight virtually. They got to hear the discussion over here and be part of this group online. And so we were practicing some of this tonight through our own platform here at Vanderbilt. So I do want to thank Joe and Jessica for helping us to make that possible, and our camera person back here. I also want to thank all of the leadership of Common Ground, both past and present, for really helping us to think about these kinds of issues. I remember when this idea came up for Common Ground, and you're exactly right, it was to bring our college together and kind of tear down some of those silos and departments and programs and have discussions like this, and to bring new ideas to the table and to hear about things that faculty and students are doing and how we're thinking about all of this. I want to thank Andy for being here tonight and really kicking off this discussion on online learning. I want to thank Kathleen and Jeff for being here because career services is another very important component of the college. I think you know how important it is, and we really have a model here at the college that supersedes just about any model in the country of placement of our professional students. We also have a pretty robust PopGE office for professional students and student organizations and various activities and functions. I want to thank Heather Repito. If you have not met Heather, Heather is in the back with Lamar, and she is our new assistant director in the PopGE office. She's been on the job for about 3 weeks now. She helped us put this event together. I do want to thank Lamar and Roz for helping us with refreshments. We're going to have some more and a nice reception, so I know I'm standing between you and the reception. But I want to say one thing to you. In about 2 to 3 weeks, to you is coming back to meet with Jeff and Kathleen, myself and Heather, to talk about how we build that online community to interact with our on-campus community. And we went to them and we said, the Peabody experience is something that we don't want to lose because we go online. And so some of the things that you were asking Andy, we are working on, and we are going to hopefully have some student focus groups to help us think through this. I have been really excited about Common Ground. You know, we had two people fly back in. They're talking to us about how we make this alumni network and how we really keep the Peabody community and the Peabody difference intact, whether you are an online student or an on-campus student. And so some of the things that Andy told you about, yes, we are going to have ways that online students can be part of our student government, can be part of organizations, take leadership roles for their online cohorts. We are thinking about lots of those things to engage students and to enhance our own work and to really grow what we do, because I think we're going to learn some things from online students that's going to enhance on-campus work too, not just the reverse. And I have to tell you, for a person who had to do their dissertation on a Selectric typewriter, who did not have a cell phone, who had a transistor radio, who had a black and white TV, this is pretty amazing to me, and I'm sure that it may be pretty amazing to you. And I am so excited about this, and I love learning from the Andy Van Checks of the world and from all of the students who bring these kinds of new ideas. And so I just want you to know that we are open to those possibilities. We want not just change, we want progress. And so I really appreciate Andy making that differential, and that we're going to work to become a real model in this about building community, student engagement, faculty engagement, and having our community come together for progress, not just change. So thank you all for attending. We hope you will enjoy the desserts and some other refreshments, okay? Some adult beverages tonight, okay? Thank you all for coming.